Welcome to Lachelle's Point of View, giving all glory to God. My name is Louise Jones, and my co-host is Tierra. And we are from Stop the Violence Prayer Chain. Take it away, students.
Good evening. Welcome. My name is Taha, and I go to Pleasantville Elementary School.
Hi, my name is Carly. I'm in fifth grade, and I go to Pleasantville Elementary School.
Hello, my name is Tyler, and I go to Pleasantville Elementary School.
I think the tradition for the show for Stop the Violence Prayer Chain Foundation is to pray before we start the show, and I've been given that responsibility honor by Minister Margaret. God, we bow our heads, please. Heavenly Father, blessed Father, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for this opportunity just to come together and to be a part of this wonderful show. We thank you for all the fellowship that we're going to engage in this evening. Let it be fun and let it be a learning experience for all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Dr. Gordon, where did you go to middle school, and what did you do there?
First of all, good afternoon or good evening. How are you? I'm from North Carolina, and as you might know, prior to going to medical school, one is required to go to college. So I attended college at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, and also attended medical school after college at the same place, University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill.
Mr. Gregory, what do you find most challenging about your job?
The most challenging thing about being an attorney is being patient. I wouldn't say that that was the case when I started off as a young attorney, but as an older attorney, more seasoned attorney, being patient with my clients and listening to their concerns and then trying to formulate a path forward. So the most challenging thing is my being patient.
Ms. Trina, can you tell us what a midwife is and what do you do?
Well, hello, and thank you for having me. A midwife, the word midwife means with woman. Just as an obstetrician, gynecologist, I see women do their GYN visits. I deliver babies as well. But as being a midwife, I spend a little bit more time with my ladies and caring for them overall. Besides delivering their babies and besides caring for them, giving them their GYN care and their OB visits when they're pregnant, I tend to find out how they're living, what their means are, what they do for a living. I tend to really become involved with the woman in her entire life as well as her family.
What do you find most enjoyable about your job, Mr. Gregory?
Mr. Gregory.
Oh, I'm sorry. Dr.
You looked
Dr.
the wrong
Gordon.
Way.
Who is that question for?
Dr. Gordon.
Okay. Dr. Gordon.
Boy, it's all a lot of fun. You know, I think the one thing I enjoy most, though, is delivering babies. Very rewarding to be a part of a family and to watch. I've been in practice of medicine now for 30 years, and to watch those young babies grow up to be adults is a very rewarding experience. And believe it or not, I've probably delivered 5,000 babies over my career, and that would make a small town in some places. So that's been the most enjoyable part.
Mr. Gregory, where did you go to law school, and why did you choose that school?
I went to the University of Florida in Gainesville, and it's kind of interesting, University of Florida chose me. I didn't choose University of Florida, although there was this program I was participating in, and they presented themselves as an option for me to apply to with two other schools. The first time I applied, I didn't get in, so my application went to the special program, and Florida said that we think that you have a profile and scores and your activities in college and your life experiences that we would like for you to apply to us. So I applied to University of Florida, Then I got into Villanova after that, but I was already at Florida in the University of Richmond. Those were schools that said, apply to us and you may get in, but they were not my initial choices. So the University of Florida kind of chose me. But the weather didn't help. The weather and going to Florida was really promising. So I really was blessed to have the opportunity to go to Florida.
Miss Trina, what were you really good at in school?
Playing tennis.
All right. Dr. Gordon, what do you find most challenging about your job?
Being responsible for another person's life is a challenge. And so, you know, healthcare and making sure that people stay healthy is an awesome responsibility. So that's a big challenge. And the other big challenge is delivering babies and being up late at night. And, you know, there are times when I'm in the hospital for more than 24 hours in a row, and that's quite a challenge, and not being able to get as much sleep as I would like to get sometimes.
Mr. Gregory, how many years did it take for law school?
Okay. Well, you go 4 years to undergrad, and I went to University of Delaware. I then went to University of Florida, which has an interesting story behind it. University of Florida had a quarter system, and that was the first time I ever experienced a quarter system. So there are four quarters in a year. You're supposed to do it in 3 years by taking the summer off or one quarter off normally in the summer. I didn't have anything else to do, and you know, I didn't have a lot of money, and I had three hots in a cot right on campus. That means a bed and a roof over my head. And I was married, my wife was in grad school, so I stayed in school the whole time, and I finished in 2.25 years. So I did a 3-year program in 2.25 years because it put a roof over my head, and I had my meals paid for, and I didn't have anything else to do. So I stayed in school.
Dr. Gordon, do you ever see the babies after they grow up?
Yes, I do, quite often. Having been in practice for 30 years, you can imagine that some of the first babies that I delivered are now 30 years old. So I, not only have I seen them, some of them grow up, or a lot of them grow up, I've actually delivered their babies. So young men and women that I delivered years and years ago are now parents themselves, and I've had the good fortune of being a part of their families as well, so it's been a great experience.
Ms. Trina, are there any negatives of your job?
Not at all. I love what I do, so there are no negatives.
Dr. Gordon, why did you decide to become an obstetrician?
That's a good question. You know, I think the real reason was because of the joy of childbirth and seeing babies. You know, healthcare, when you're a doctor, some areas of medicine, the outcome is not always positive. You know, your patients don't do as well when they have cancer sometimes, or heart conditions, or diabetes and other serious illnesses. But in obstetrics in particular, because most parents are young and healthy, the outcome is a good one. So watching a woman go through 9 months, and her husband and significant other go through 9 months of pregnancy and then deliver a healthy baby is a very rewarding experience, not only for the parents, but for the provider, and in this case, me as well.
Ms. Trina, how long does it take a baby to grow?
Well, Dr. Gordon just answered that question. It takes 9 months.
Mm-hmm. So that you know, you just got a cue to ask that question. In the law, one of the biggest mistakes that a young lawyer makes is to ask a question, it's answered, and you still have it written down, and you still ask the same question. One of the biggest mistakes lawyers make. It's already answered. I was trying to give you a signal and say,
yeah.
Well, we're okay. Okay. You're not on TV, so they don't know who did it.
Mr. Gregory, did any class you took in elementary or middle school get you interested in becoming a lawyer?
No, it wasn't a class. Well, I did have business law in high school, and I was intrigued with business law. But what really got me interested in the law was my mother, who encouraged me to be a lawyer. I was her little lawyer. Now, we can contrast that with my grandmother, who said that I was her little preacher. And I just didn't think that was going to work. So it's interesting how your family influences what you become. But my mom always saw me as her little lawyer. And of course, I had no idea I could do it based on my background. But the seed was planted, and I got good grades. I managed to go to the University of Delaware, still got good grades. I'm looking around, and folk are going to law school, so I decided I could go to law school. So it wasn't a class, it was my mother.
I think we have a question over here for you.
Mr. Gregory, what quote would you use to describe your daily life?
Prayer of Serenity. At 65 years of age, it's become the prayer of serenity.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Miss Trina, how many hours do you work in a typical week?
In a week? That can vary. Let's see, generally, it's pretty busy. So maybe 50, 40. If I'm on call for 24 hours, it can be more than that. So, yeah, it's a lot of hours, but they're all well worth it.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Gordon, did any class you took in elementary school or middle school, did any of those classes inspire you to become a doctor?
You know, no, I don't think there was any particular class at an early age, but I sort of, in my own mind, when I was a younger child, did think that I wanted to go to medical school, but it wasn't because of any particular class that I took. But I liked going to school, I liked working hard. I was fortunate to get good grades a lot of times, and so knowing that medical school was going to be an academic challenge for me, I thought it was a good opportunity to go down that road, and that's
Olympics.
What I chose to do.
Dr. Court, we heard you judge swimming in Olympics. Tell us more.
Yes, interesting. This past summer, the Olympics, as you probably remember, was in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. And I've been a judge for swimming for probably about 20 years now. My children were both swimmers when they grew up here at Delaware, and my son swam in college. So I had the good fortune of being asked to be a part of the Olympics this past year, and I was the starter, the person that says, take your mark and hits the horn when the swimmers are all in the blocks. I was the starter for all of the men's events, and got to start all of Michael Phelps' races. I don't know if any of you guys know Michael Phelps, seen Michael Phelps, but he's probably the most famous swimmer in the world. And it was a great experience. Brazil is a beautiful country, and Rio is a beautiful city. Some great athletes there. Serena was there, and her sister Venus were there in tennis. Of course, Simone, the gymnast, is it Biles? I think it's Biles, yes. So you got to meet and see a lot of the greatest athletes in the world. And it was two weeks of this past summer that, you know, always be a part of my life and memories that I'll always cherish.
Mr. Gregory, what were you really good at in school?
I'm gonna give you two phases. As an adult, my mom, who's since passed away, she was taking out our report cards and going over it, and he said that Theophilus would do better in school if he would sit in his seat. Theophilus would do better in school if he stopped socializing. Theophilus would do better in school if he would stop touching other people. So I think I was pretty good at being a social butterfly in elementary school. Now, when I got to high school, I think that I was good at getting along well with people. And I think that my yearbook reflects that, what people had to say about me, being someone who got along with everybody and talked to everybody. And we had a very diverse school, racially, and different ethnics and different religions. And I think I was good at getting along well with everyone and being a well-rounded person, in my opinion.
I think we have a question over here.
I really asked. Don't ask that question. You better make another one up.
Make up.
Mr. Gregory, what subject did you like in school?
What subject did I like? I tell you what I liked in law school, and I loved it, administrative law, because it was it's like constitutional law, but it's more dealing with administrative agencies and talking about due process and notice and comment, giving people an opportunity to explore rulemaking. That was the course I liked the most in law school. The course I liked the most in college was philosophy, because there was no real answer. You know, it was vague. You could just talk forever with some of the subjects, and it was based on just some life experiences. So those would be the two courses I liked the most. See, I helped you. I helped you, didn't I? You know you're older, right?
How many years have you been a midwife?
I've been a midwife now for 9 years.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Gordon, what age were you when you decided to become a doctor?
Well, I was young when I thought I wanted to be a doctor. You know, I would say probably about 12 or 13, it started to enter my mind that becoming a doctor was something that I would like to think about. But, you know, typically, as you'll find out, you go to college after high school. So I was 18 when I entered college. And then I was pretty sure at that point that I wanted to go on to medical school. So college was for 4 years, and I was 22, and then entered med school at age 22.
Mr. Gregory, what advice would you give to students who are interested in becoming a lawyer?
Critical thinking. Learn how to read, learn how to write, and take as many courses as you can to teach you critical thinking, logic, philosophy. Those kinds of courses are really the kinds of skills you need. Then, of course, you get into economics and a lot of other different things. But if you're not a critical thinker, and if you can't read and write and comprehend what you're reading and what you're writing, that's the most important thing you can do to become a lawyer. Not necessarily math. You know, I could be a lawyer but math helped me to understand sets and subsets. Even that's critical thinking, but in terms of using it, I use basically business math, practical math that gets me through every day. But what you really need to do is critical thinking and comprehension.
We have another question over here.
Ms. Gina, what quote would you use to describe your daily life?
Well, there are two quotes that I have, and I tend to give these quotes to my students because I teach as well, midwives up and coming. And one is, be confident but humble, meaning to have confidence in yourself and believe in what you're doing, but to be humble, meaning that to ask questions. If you feel that, you know, you're not sure of what you're doing, to ask someone. The other quote that I like for myself is, she believed she could, so she did. And so if I believe in myself and know that there's something that I can do or that I want to do, I do it. and I'm confident enough to know that I can.
Dr. Gordon, who is or was your mentor? What did they teach you?
That's a good question. You know, more than a mentor, though, I think the person that meant the most to me outside my parents, who taught me most of the things that I learned in life, early on in particular. But probably Dr. King was the one hero and person that I admired more than any other. I grew up in North Carolina in the 60s as a young child, and it was during a time when there were a lot of racial difficulties, and to watch a person give his life for the things that meant so much to all of us just had an impact on me that I'll probably take to my grave. I mean, it's when you think about how much he sacrificed for us to live a better life and for the world to be a better place, I think you could have no better hero than that person. So mentor, yes, but hero, definitely.
Do the guests have any questions for us?
Yes, I have one. Do you watch CNN or Fox News? Do you know of any personalities on TV that ask questions on any news channels?
No, not really.
Well, let me ask it broader. If you were, who on TV would you say you most resemble or act like you?
I do not know.
You don't have any?
Not 100% sure.
Well, give me 99%. I'm going to come back to you because you have time to think now, but you go ahead.
I'm not sure either.
You don't know either? Okay, you are, we're going to make you, what's the guy's name on Today Show? Matt Lauer. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're going to make you Sanjay Gupta. We're going to make you, who?
Sue Serio.
Are you Sue Serio?
Yeah.
Now you have to go find out who all those people are. But you're not really Matt Lauer, because he's bald and got dark hair. We're going to let it go at that.
What do you guys want to be when you grow up?
I would like to be a Major League Baseball player.
I did too when I was your age. So what's your second choice? Keep the dream, but what have you got a plan B?
Doctor.
Okay, all right.
I would like to be a doctor.
Okay, good.
What kind of doctor? You two said doctor.
A child's doctor.
Pediatrician.
Sports medicine.
Okay.
Oh, nice. I would like to work in an animal sanctuary.
In an animal?
Sanctuary.
Okay.
Oh, beautiful.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Good.
Any more questions?
How about you, ladies? What would you like to be when you grow up?
I would like to be, well, I did want to be a nurse, but I changed my mind. I'm helping Minister Guy as a receptionist at her building.
Yes.
And I'm helping her with the children also. I'm going to college for computers and technology.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I'm going to study for probably 2 years, maybe four, if I change my mind.
Very good.
You're allowed to change your mind a whole lot of times. Mm-hmm. I just want you to know that. So don't, it's okay. It's normal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Doctor.
Doctor.
Do you know any doctors?
Besides Dr. Gordon.
Okay.
Right.
Anybody? Know any doctors personally? Yes, no?
Not really.
Okay. Any TV doctors? You know any TV doctors?
No.
Okay. Just curious. The famous TV doctor that we all think back on is Dr. Cosby on The Cosby Show. I don't know if you remember. That show probably was more popular when you were a little bit too young to watch TV, maybe.
I really aged myself.
It was really a great show, though.
Yeah. I went back to Welby.
Welby, yeah, Marcus Welby.
I went all the way back to Welby.
Yeah, Kildare. You remember Dr.
Yeah.
Kildare?
Yeah, I skipped right over him.
Yeah. Ben Casey was another TV person.
That's right.
They lost me here. I'm the baby in the middle.
Wow.
Very good.
Any more questions?
Well, thanks, ladies, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Really appreciate you
having
us on.
Yeah, this was great.
Welcome.
That's a break, so that means we're going to now change this.
Welcome back to A Child's Point of View. My name is Louise Jones, and this is my co-host, Tavon Reynolds. I would like to introduce our guests this evening, Dr. Gordon and Dr. Evans and Mr. Gregory.
I wish I was a doctor, but...
So let's take it away.
Hello, I am Malachi Wise from Pleasantville Elementary School.
Hello, my name is Adriana Hutton. I go to Southern Elementary School and I am in the fifth grade.
Hello, my name is John Shake. I go to Southern Elementary School and I'm in the fifth grade.
Mr. Evans, can you describe a typical work day?
That's an interesting question. A typical work day is always busy, you know, in the hospitality industry, especially the hotel business, is 24/7. You know, as a director of operations, my job is to make sure the team is, you know, in sync and everything going right. So I could be there sometimes as early as 6 o'clock and leave work as late as 1 a.m. Yep.
Dr. Gregory, can you tell us your favorite moment from the Olympics and why it was your favorite?
I think that would be me, Gordon, Dr. Gordon. But yes, the Olympics, I worked in the Olympics this past year in Rio, and I was one of the starters, swimming officials for USA Swimming, representing the United States. There were two officials from this country, 26 officials from around the world. And probably the most exciting moment was being the starter of all of Michael Phelps' events. And that was just, it was tremendously exciting. And as you might imagine, you might not know, I have a poolside seat for all of the races. So watching all of the competition was just tremendously exciting.
My most exciting moment was when I woke up after a dream and I thought I had won the 100 meter dash. That was a joke. I'm sorry.
Mr. Gregory, how many cases have you won?
You know, that's an interesting question for a lawyer. Winning is relative. You're trying to get the best result for your client. You're trying to make your client whole again, is what we call it. So you may not get the whole ball of wax, meaning 100%, but you made them better off than what they were going in. So that's the best way to explain that. So you don't keep, you can't, it's hard to keep score. I would like to think that I was very successful. I am very successful in winning cases and better positioning my clients.
Mr. Gregory, can you tell us about your most challenging cases you won?
I did five homicide cases where I represented the defendant that had allegedly committed the murders. The most challenging one was, oh man, they were all challenging. The most challenging one was when I represented Lonnie Barnes. He was in his 60s, maybe early 70s. His wife had died, he remarried, and he was, had a girl, she was a young lady, but she really used him and abused him. It was really nasty what she did to him. And he got to drinking, got to thinking about it, got a gun, and he killed her. But he only got a manslaughter. When we went to trial, the jury convicted him of manslaughter and possession of a firearm during the commission of that felony. So he only got 13 years. He was really a pathetic client that you would really have a lot of empathy for, because the facts showed, and no one deserves to die. No one deserves or have a right to kill anybody else. But she had went through his whole life savings, and she had other relationships. He thought that she worked at a bank at night, when in fact she was going out doing everything that she could do under the sun. And when he confronted her with it, she was really mean. I mean, she said some stuff to him, and it brought him to tears. And he made the mistake of drinking. And he drank, and he drank, and he drank, and he drank. And he was in Newark. And he got from Newark to Lancaster Avenue in his car. He has no idea how he got there. And he killed her and just sat on the sofa. That was murder one all day long. Life or death. I got him 10 years. But it was very, very challenging for me because he was one of the clients that I believed in. You know, you kind of take ownership, and I really believed in him, and I just didn't want him to spend the rest of his life in jail. I had empathy for the victim and her family, but I just thought that, and actually the jury didn't want to convict him of that. I'm told they were crying and fussing and fighting, and they said, well, we got to convict him of something because he did kill her. But that was very, very challenging emotionally for me, physically stand up at night, spiritually for me because I'm conflicted. So it was very challenging.
Mr. Evans, what were you really good at in school?
Well, academics, I think I was very good in English, literature. I love reading. Physically, I played soccer. Actually, I went to University of Delaware. I graduated in business management there. And I played soccer for at least, I think it was 2.5 years. So. Great.
Dr. Gordon, do you perform surgeries? What hospital do you work at most often?
Good question. I work strictly at Christiana Hospital. But yes, I do surgery. One of the beauties of being an obstetrician is that you do medicine and surgery. So you get a mix of the two, and that makes it a little more exciting. Each day offers something new. But as far as surgery that you might be able to relate to, cesarean section, you know what that is? When babies are delivered, when mothers can't have normal vaginal deliveries, cesarean section is a delivery through an abdominal incision.
Walked into that one,
did you? Yeah, I did.
But I know you did.
But hey, you know,
it is what it
they
is.
They probably could tell me. But so yeah, you do get to do a lot of surgery. Now you get to do a lot of robotic surgery as times have changed since I first came into medicine, and it's just, who knows? I mean, in the next 10 years, or by the time one of you finishes med school, there's no telling what will be out there.
Mr. Gregory, is there a lot of paperwork along with being a lawyer? A
whole lot of paperwork. But let me say this, and I must say that I have not kept up with the time. A lot of the paperwork now is no longer hard paper, it's technology. But I still, because I came along during an era where I needed to read it, I still need my stuff printed out because I need to mark it up by hand because I'm not that tech savvy. So yes, there's a lot of paperwork, and there's, again, reading and writing. Those are our tools. Those are the skills that we use. So the answer is yes, but you got to stay organized and know how to keep it together. You know how to find. You can have a notebook that thick in court, but you got to have it tabbed in such a way that you can find it. You don't have to have it all up here, but you have to be able to find it. So there's a lot of paperwork.
Mr. Evans, have you ever had anyone famous in your hotel?
Yeah, I'm trying to think. Actually, it's probably 2 weeks ago, we had some boxers stay at our hotel, and the name escapes me, and that's really tough. I think it was, yeah, Roy Jones Jr. He is the current bantamweight champion of the world, and he was at our hotel, stayed there for 3 days. Yeah.
Mr. Gregory, did you show leadership at your school, high school, or college?
The answer is yes. From middle school, high school, college, I showed leadership. Through elected office and through, again, being a well-rounded person and helping people. So that's one of my strengths. but being a leader isn't easy. There's a lot of sacrifice that goes into leading, in my opinion, but I've done that my entire life, been a leader. Football, I was captain of all my teams in high school and other programs in high school, and went to University of Delaware. Wasn't the captain, I played football, but I was on the team and played a leadership role there. The answer is yes. I say that kind of hesitantly and with some pain, because I've been through a whole lot of rodeos.
Dr. Gordon, are there too many or too few people entering this profession?
Too few. Healthcare is the most important aspect, I think, of our daily lives, and we don't have enough people providing health care to the people in this country. I don't know if you watch much news, but you know now that the Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare, is under attack by the Congress and our new president, mm-hmm. as they're trying to repeal and at least hopefully replace it if they repeal it. But health care is so critical to you and to me and to your parents and to all of us that we can't have too many providers.
Mr. Evans, was it hard to find a job?
Well, it depends on where you're looking. Probably no, because I really didn't start in the hospitality, industry. When I graduated, I worked in D.C. in property management, which really is similar to what I do now. And then, a good friend asked me to come work with him. So I was lucky. I didn't have to go looking for a job. It sort of found me,
What evidence would you give to students who are interested in hospitality?
Very good question. I think what I like about the hospitality industry is that there are many, many positions that, is available for anyone who's willing to work hard. If you take sales, you can be the vice president of sales, or you can be a sales agent, or mid management can be a sales manager. You can be the CEO of the of that hospitality industry or that particular company. It's really just the ability to study hard, willing to work hard, and starting somewhere and just kind of working your way, to the top. But I think it's one of the industries where it's easy to the upward mobility, that is, getting promoted and kind of moving up, is fairly accessible and easy if you work hard at it.
Think of all the places you could live if you were in hospitality.
Oh,
Hawaii,
absolutely. Yes.
Or
yep.
New York, yep. Or
Jamaica, or Brazil. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. A lot of options, huh?
Yes. Yes.
Mr. Gregory, how realistic are the lawyer-based TV shows them being compared to the actual thing?
They are very, very unfavorably misleading. They make our job much harder in the real world, because everybody thinks that it's, you ask the magical question, didn't you do it, and the person break down on the stand. Doesn't happen that way. The TV shows are just so off base. Even the incident happens in the first 5 minutes of the show, and 20 minutes into the show, they're going to trial. No, maybe a year later you're going to trial, and there's so much behind the scenes that go into it. Even some of their questions that they ask aren't appropriate questions. They're leading questions, as we call it. They solicit hearsay. So I've had clients who've actually tried to tell me that I could do it a certain way because they saw it on TV. No, it doesn't work that way. So it makes my job very hard. Very, very hard, because people have unrealistic expectations.
Mr. Evans, what are three words you would use to describe yourself?
Three words. I think enthusiastic. kind, and happy.
Dr. Gordon, do you have any funny stories about babies?
Oh, wow. Probably none that I can tell on TV. I guess one of the funny stories you probably would imagine is how often when babies are born that they actually pee on you as a doctor, because that's the first thing they do. And so parents get a big thrill out of that when it happens. But that's probably the funniest thing that happens on a regular basis anyway.
Mr. Evans, what hotel do you manage and where is it?
Okay, we're the Clarion Hotel, the Bell, and we're on 1612 North DuPont Highway. For Barron's, I usually like to kind of use it as a as a landmark, but we are kind of adjacent to the Grace Lawn Memorial, and also not too far from the Social Services Building. So we're right on Route 13.
Mr. Gregory, what quote would you describe your daily life?
What quote would I use to describe my daily life? I don't know. My favorite quote is the prayer of serenity. I guess I need that to get through the day, so my day is hectic. I don't have a quote that describes my daily life. I'm sorry.
Dr. Gordon, if you weren't a doctor, what would you want to be and why?
Wow, that's a very good question. You know, my favorite subject in school was math. And my daughter just graduated from Georgetown, and her major was math, and she's gone on to business school. And I've sort of become a little envious of that opportunity that she's in grad school at Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh now. And so I think I would be in a position where numbers were really important, dealing with numbers every day. Wall Street would be wonderful to be on Wall Street in New York.
Mr. Gregory, where is the interesting place you have traveled?
Through the South. I went to the Lorraine Hotel where Dr. King was assassinated. I went up to St. Augustine, Florida, where they brought the slaves in. And a lot of the locations, the apparatuses are still there. They were very moving, you know, just to be in that environment. With those two locations, and there are others down through the South, in Atlanta, some places that I went to just get in touch with my history and the history of America. So it's in this country. You know, I've been to the Caribbean and some places, but the most interesting has been through the Deep South and just envisioning and imagining plantations, what it would be like. What would it have been like if I were there?
Mr. Evans, who inspires you?
Good question. I think I'm inspired by my family. Well, I know I'm the breadwinner or the provider for them. So I am inspired to make sure that I do what I need to do to make sure they're taken care of. My children, I have a son who's in the Navy in Japan, you know, I'm very proud of, and my two boys in high school, and a little girl who I call Shadow. He follows me around everywhere.
Mr. Evans, can you tell us what it was like growing up in Guyana?
In Ghana, yeah. Well, for the audience, I was born in Ghana, which is in Western Africa. You know, and I came to college here when I was 18. Grew up in Ghana, you know, I mean, again, it's always interesting because sometimes what you see on television with, you know, the Tarzan movies is really not how it is. I can tell you that. But that said, too, growing up, it wasn't anything like, you know, you guys have it now. I mean, I grew up where, you know, we went to an outhouse. I don't know if you guys know what an outhouse is, but there was no indoor plumbing. You literally go outside the building, you know, and a little kind of looks like a kiosk, you know, we call latrine. It's where you go to the bathroom. And you had to go running water is going to the river, infection water, you know, for a while until we moved to the city where you had, water tap, but it wasn't in the building. You literally have to go outside and pump it to get it back indoors. But at the same token, it was great because my family provided the push education. I mean, that's the reason why I'm here. Education was the center of our conversation at home. My father said, you're going to college, and there was no discussion. You are going to college, hook or crook, you know, and I appreciate that.
Let me go back and answer that question you asked me about a quote. It's not a quote that some famous person coined, but I always say I'm going to do my job. Right. I'm going to do my job. Do your job. And I think that's what a leader does. Yes. You know, it can be painful. It can be discouraging. But at the bottom line, do your job. If that's your job, do your job.
And do it well.
That's right. Amen. Do your job.
Amen.
Do you guys have any questions for us?
And one observation. We all said we were good students, good in academics, but we all said something else. But you don't have to do what we did, but you should do something similar. Swimmer, soccer, football player, competitive. We did something beyond academics. So you can be in the play, you can be in the choir, you can be in boys' state, girls' state, whatever they have out there now, the Spanish club, this club, but do something beyond the academics. Swimmer, soccer, football. There's a reason for that pattern.
What's your favorite subject in school?
My favorite subject in school is, not everyone likes this, but I like social studies a lot.
Interesting.
I agree with John. My favorite subject in school is social studies.
Why social studies?
I kind of like the idea how, like, if social studies involves history a little, and it involves, like, places, and I'm just like, I'm that person that just loves history and stuff, and there's not that much else to it.
You would probably be a big help to our president.
Ouch.
Yeah.
And you?
My favorite subject is math.
Math, good.
That's good.
That was mine as well.
Well, I enjoy social studies. Actually, I had 2 degrees, one in business management, and also in sociology. You know, I mean, I enjoy knowing what goes on and how people think and socialize, you know, in society. So,
same question. You guys got to answer the question.
Favorite
subject?
My favorite subject was science.
Science?
Okay. My favorite subject is math because we get to learn about angles, numbers, and algebra and stuff like that.
You know why I liked math, though? Because it had an answer. You know, so many things, you don't have an answer. People say, well, I like the way you said that, or I don't like the way you said that. Yeah. But in math, there was always one answer, and if you got it right, you got it right. No one could say that's not the right answer. So.
That's true. Yeah. Now, listen, though. But then you get points off because they want to look at your work.
Yeah,
and say,
how you got to that.
You didn't get there right. You go, well, wait a minute. I got the answer.
Ah, no question.
But you didn't. You know, see, I would do it in trial and error. I knew I was going to be close. Yeah. So I had these little formulas I'd figure out and get there, but it didn't count because I didn't do it the right way. I think they call that new math now and then.
Right.
I think it's good to be interested in math. I tell my kids that life is really math. I mean, when you walk, you are doing math because you can't ask the question about how long, you know, or how many minutes or how many steps you take, you know, to point A, you know, from A to B, you know, and you can calculate that. Anything, even when you're chewing, you can't do math by chewing. So everything is all about math. And I admire people that are good with numbers. You know, I envy them.
But even people with other talents, it's amazing. Musicians are known to be tied into math.
Into math.
That math is just sort of the common language.
Yes, absolutely.
So
okay. You gotta wrap it up. Do it.
Mr. Gregory, how many hours do you typically work in a week?
At my peak, when I was practicing and I was growing and tried to do everything I could do in just probably 80 hours. Now I work about 40 hours. But at one time I worked 80 hours a week. I literally worked 80 hours a week. But now I'm long, you know, you have seasons in your life. So I'm in the season of my life now where I'm at about 40 hours a week. My wife's retired, but I'm still working. I probably will never retire. I'll probably be sitting at my desk and just fall over. I used to say they were going to pull me up by my hair and look at me and make sure, but yeah. I don't have any hair now. So they'll probably just tip me up.
Mr. Evans, what do you spend the most time doing at your job?
Well, I think for my job, I consider myself as like the conductor. You know, if you take a, orchestra, the conductor has to make sure, everyone, all the musicians, are in tune and that they've practiced their notes and that when we're ready to perform, everyone is in sync. You know, so I am about trying to make sure all the managers, all the line workers, everybody has the tools and understand our objective and our goal. You know, and so that's what I do, and it can take me, again, I said, from coming in early in the morning because there's a huge event going on, there's a group coming into the hotel, and I want to make sure that, everyone, I am kind of like the gopher, I'm there to help everyone, cheerleader, help them kind of get the little things that need to kind of get everything together so that the music sounds like perfect. That's what I do.
Thank you for tuning in to this episode of A Child's Point of View. We hope you enjoyed our special guests this evening, Dr. Gordon, Daryl Gregory, and Max Evans. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.